20-odd minutes, we'll have Rana speak about... Okay, she sacrificed 5 more minutes on the Gujarat Files, the anatomy of a cover-up. After which she'll take questions from you, and the prerogative of choosing who will ask the questions would be arbitrarily mine.
That's fascism.
Learn to live with it in small doses first. So, and for those of you who feel a little uncomfortable, I could also introduce her as Maithili Tyagi for you. So, ladies and gentlemen, from we're going to look into this window of the same place Sabarmati Ki Sant to the Chai Wala. Is this the progress? Is this India's tryst with destiny? Over to Rana Ayub.
Adab Hyderabad and Namaskaram. Actually, I've been a bit tired of speaking, to be very honest, which is why I deducted the 5 minutes. For the last 1 month, I've been speaking, but speak I must, because that's all I have to bring the truth to all of you. It took me about 5 years to get the book out. I might as well speak for another 6 months to ensure that all of you hear and read it as much as possible. I don't know, what do I say? Some of you must have read the book. Some of you might be privy to the content of the book. It's been an arduous process. I mean, at the end, I went to my shrink after the book launch and I said, am I allowed to cry now? He said, not yet, you have another month to cry. But now you have to ensure that the courts ask you for the tapes of this conversation. The reason why I speak is because I see all of you in huge numbers today promising to me that the hope, there's still hope, there's still hope for justice, there's a lot of optimism, that a percent of a minority of fascists, I would say, because I still believe and I choose to believe that India is a justice-loving country, and I continue to believe that, despite having seen it at, from closest quarters, right from the Mumbai riots to the Gujarat riots. I mean, I'm a child of the Mumbai riots. I mean, I'm born and brought up in Mumbai, so I know what transpired. My parents sent me and my sister across to an unknown place for 2 months where we did not have any telephonic conversation with the family. And one fine day we had a poster. I mean, my father was a government school teacher who belonged to a socialist family, and he worked with the Blitz, a very well-known journalist, government school teacher, the only Muslim family in a cosmopolitan Hindu society, and one fine day on 6 December 1992, we all became Muslims. Because a poster which read Chalo Ayodhya 6 December was stuck right in the middle of our house, and acid bottles thrown inside. And my mother's closest friend came to her that morning and said, Didi, Ayodhya se bheeni bheeni khushboo aa rahi hai, lagta hai masjid toot chuki hai. This is not, I'm not blaming auntie. I'm blaming the people who we have elected to power. I want to us to introspect, because Modi and the likes of Amit Shah didn't come to power just like that. They came in power with a democratically elected setup. We voted them to power. So, you know, when we kind of lament the fact that extrajudicial killings or the practice of Hindutva or fascism is being practiced, we have to look inward somewhere that, you know, we voted them to power, so let's also look inwards. Let's point a finger towards our own self. Where have we come in as a society? Gujarat Files is a result of an 8-month-long undercover investigation, which I did right after, at the age of 26, I sent the country's first Home Minister Amit Shah behind bars in 2010 on charges of murder and conspiracy. I was only 26 then, and infamously known as Mr. Ayub. Nobody thought that a girl would do that. Till 2013, I'd only get emails and letters as Mr. Ayub. Fortunately for me, it allowed me to go undercover. So nobody could figure that it was a girl who was actually Rana Ayub. I sent him behind bars, and I knew that this was just a Amit Shah, the man who the Supreme Court of India, in its order, has called a murderer and a conspirator, who is, unfortunately, and I have no issues saying this right now, is the president of the ruling party in this country, and we are witness to this. He was responsible for the murder of innocents, and those innocents on whose murder, on whose bodies Mr. Narendra Modi would take press conferences and call himself a Hindu Hriday Samrat who was under attack from Fidayeens. This book is because, it's for that very reason, because reams have been written about the book, but I do believe that most of us, irrespective of whether judgment, justice happens or not, we have to keep talking, we have to keep doing the work that we are doing. The fourth estate, which I myself so proudly believe I'm a part of, has to keep doing its work. 1 month since the publication of this book, not a single television news channel has touched it. I think they have developed amnesia, partial amnesia, because they all love talking about Vijay Mallya and black money, but they can't see fascism back in the country. Having said that, I'm fortunate that most of the print media, online media, has given glorifying reviews to the book. I've got news reports coming in each day, so that's very, very heartening and promising. Gujarat Files is also a result of mainstream media censorship. I did this investigation. I went incognito in 2010 July as Maitri Tyagi, a student of the American Film Institute Conservatory, an American, a filmmaker who sported a bandana. You know, any American who speaks with an accent is very much acceptable in Ahmedabad. Anybody who's familiar with Gujarat will know that. Plus, the fact that my father was an RSS worker and he was a Sanskrit professor came in very handy. I mean, Maitri's father, to be precise. I had a French accomplice who was an intern at Tehelka who came along. There was somebody from Greenland who also became a cinematographer. And thus started this journey of filmmaking of Gujarat, or the vibrant Gujarat. And I finished this investigation in 2011, only to be told by Tehelka that it could not publish this. After which, every publication whose books you buy each day has been approached with this manuscript. The biggest publication house in this country had a contract with me for 1 year, and suddenly one fine day in 2014 January, the same year that Modi was supposed to come to power, they stopped taking my phone calls. No phones, no messages. For a month I went on enduring this. I thought, okay, perhaps my editor must be really busy. After about a month, I tried a trick. I sent them a mail, I'm withdrawing my book. Within 2 minutes came a response, please go ahead. So the trick worked wonders. They wanted me to do it. I went to every possible editor in this country, and no editor in this country can claim that I have not spoken to them about these transcripts. Some cited political pressure, some cited, oh, it's the work of Tehelka, we can't carry it. Some cited the sting operation wasn't exactly the ideal form of journalism. You know, you always have reasons. When you don't want to do something, you there are 1,000 reasons. Like my editors recently said, oh, the book did not fit the editorial standards of Tehelka. In 4 weeks, I have sold 30,000 copies that say something about the editorial standard of this country. And this is it. I mean, this is what keeps me going. This is what keeps me talking so much all the time to all of you. I'm visiting one city each day. And this is what keeps me going, that the fact that you guys really believe in the work that I'm doing, you guys still believe, a part of you, at least 10% of India still believes that what Narendra Modi and Amit Shah did in Gujarat was against humanity, was against the very grain of humanity, was injustice. And that's what keeps me going. There is a famous shair by Ahmed Faraz in Pakistan. He said it for dictator Zia at that point of time, General Zia. And he said it, the poem was aptly titled Muhasara. It was, in English, translated the siege. It was when General Zia tried to censor the mainstream media in Pakistan. And I don't know how many of you here are familiar with Urdu, but the last four lines went like this. Main kat giru ke salamat rahu, ye yakeen hai mujhe, ki ye hisaar-e-sitam koi to girayega. Tamam umr ki aza naseebiyon ki kasam, mere kalam ka safar aayega na jayega. These are the last four lines of the book. In the 8 months of investigation, I stung about 8 possible of 8 top officers, which included the principal secretary, home secretary, ATS chief, commissioner of police, deputy general of police, Maya Kurnani, who oiled my hair, of course, Narendra Modi, who told me about his fascination for Barack Obama and how he wanted to be like Barack Obama one day. And now you see him shaking hands with Barack Obama. So his dreams do come true. And various other officers, of course. But I would want to read a small part from of my conversation with then ATS chief Rajan Priyadarshi. And it has great deal of insight in it. For all those who have read it might know what it includes, but I'll just read a small part of it. It says, so I ask, your CM Narendra Modi is very popular here in Gujarat. Answer, yes, he fools everybody and people get fooled. Question, in that case, as additional DJ, you would have had a tough time walking under him. Answer, they never had the guts to force me to do anything illegal. Question, lawlessness is rampant here, no? Hardly any officers are upright. Answer, there are very few of them. This man, Narendra Modi, has been responsible for killing Muslims across the street. Question, acha, I hear that the cops also towed the line of the government. Answer, all of them, like this PC Pandey, the commissioner. It all happened in their presence. Question, most of the officers say that they have been implicated wrongly. Answer, what wrongly? They have done it, which is why they are now going behind bars. They killed a young girl in an encounter. Question, really? Answer, haha. They called her Lashkar terrorist. She was from Mumbra. The story created was she was a terrorist who came to Gujarat to kill Narendra Modi. Question, and it's false? Answer, yes, it's false. This is the ATS chief and the girl in concern is Ishrat Jahan. The same Ishrat Jahan who now is being demonized on television news channels every day for the last 10 years. One day we give her a clean chit, the other day we call her a terrorist who was going around with five men. The implication is very strong, mind you. What was a single girl doing with five men in the middle of the night? I mean, irrespective of whether she was a terrorist or not, she ought to be a girl of horrible character. And that's a stream of thought which goes across the book. You have Geeta Jauri who says about Kausar B, who was Saurabhadeen's wife, who was raped, sedated and killed by Gujarat cops. She said, well, she was living in with that man. Which roughly translates into she can be raped, sedated and killed and thrown into the Narmada like she was. This is the IG of police Rajkot saying this. Another part in which the Home Secretary of Gujarat speaks to me as Maithili Tyagi, I ask him, but why has the CM been, CM Mr. Narendra Modi, we're talking about 2010, but why has the CM been so much in the line of fire? Is it because he's with the BJP? Answer, no. Because he supported the VHP during the time of the riots, he did it to get the Hindu votes, which he did. He did what he wanted to do, and that happened. Question, but he asked people to go slow. Answer, he would not say that in the meeting. He would say that to his men. He would convey to the VHP and then to officers like Tandon and other officers and the VHP. And as an officer, you can choose to toe the line. This is the Home Secretary of Gujarat who in front of the Nanavati Commission, told the Nanavati Commission, I don't remember what happened at that point of time. This was the same man who developed amnesia in front of the Nanavati Commission. Further ahead, he says, you would have had a tough time to work under Narendra Modi. Answer, they never had the guts to tell me to do anything wrong. Question, was the government's ire directed against you? Answer, yes, of course. I said, give me orders in paper, whatever it is. See, all the officers at lower levels, everybody has the right to arrest those politicians indulging in such crimes. But most of them have come under political pressure and compromise. That's what happened during the riots. On a later occasion, he says that Praveen Togaria, when he took this rally in Gujarat around the time of Gothra train burning, and Mr. Narendra Modi himself took the permission of bringing the bodies to Gujarat despite suggestion by the Home Secretary and Chief Secretary to not bring the bodies, as it did flare up the tension in Gujarat. He goes on to say in this book, on record, it was Narendra Modi's decision. He further goes on to say that he had said categorically to Mr. Modi that permission should not be given to Praveen Togaria to hold a rally, and Mr. Modi categorically asked him to give permission. If this is not evidence, I need to know what is evidence in this country. In this country where a yes or no is accepted as evidence, why is it that these many tapes and transcripts of conversations are not accepted by evidence. I'm surprised, I'm stunned. 1 month since this book launch and the SIT, the Special Investigative Team, investigated the Gujarat encounters and the Gujarat riots and the fake encounters, has not even had the courtesy to give me a phone call to ask if Maitri Tyagi or Rana Ayub even exists. And what do I say? The end of the chapter is, let me just also add one thing. The book is not about Muslims. The last chapter of the book is about the RSS Pracharak Hare Pandya, who played an active role during Gujarat riots, who according to his father died about a few years ago, who till his last breath said that his son was killed by Narendra Modi and Amit Shah, the Home Minister. I would not want to pass judgment on that because we have courts to decide on that. But the investigating officer in this case in the last chapter says that the man who killed Haren Pandya was in their custody before they let him out to kill Haren Pandya, and the CBI acted at the behest of Narendra Modi and L.K. Advani. If the investigating officer who signs the FIR is not evidence enough, I need to know what is evidence. I need to know why his Times Now not screaming on the top of his voice and talking about this investigation. I need to know what his silence about. So people ask me, a reviewer wrote the other day in Business Standard that Rana Ayub is using the same practice as Narendra Modi of crime censorship. I didn't know what to say. Perhaps censorship and its meaning needs to be redefined. I guess my book is the most discussed topic in this country. I guess the Prime Minister is holding a meeting and 7 RC are discussing this book. I'm sure they are, but certainly not in the public eye. That's what we need to ask, and that's why I'm here. I'm here not just to give you a lecture. I'm here not just to read out from the book. I'm not saying I'm the most upright person in the universe. I'm not. I've had many flaws, but I'm here to talk as somebody who considers herself justice loving and has had bouts of nervous disorders when the book was not published. I'm here to seek your support in the process of justice. And all I want from you is to raise a voice. All I want you to do is support this book, read the book and ask tough questions, and just do not be complacent and sit in your living rooms and watch television news and abuse on the Goswami. No, it's not taking us anywhere. The easiest thing is to sit in your living rooms and criticize politicians. The toughest thing is to ask questions and make yourself heard. That's the only purpose behind self-publishing this book, and still to clear the debt and the home loan, and the book loan that I took to publish this book. Inshallah, I'll be able to recover it in the next few months because of your support and because we have sold 30,000 copies so far. But the larger purpose is for this book to reach every household, for the content of this book to register in your hearts and minds, and ask yourself the question when you go to the ballot, when you go to cast your vote in the next election. Thank you.
Please be seated.